Hey, this is Steve in Dallas, Texas. It's Saturday morning, my friend, and you are listening to Light Talk.
And good morning. This is Stan coming to you from Gainesville, and you are listening to Light Talk.
And this is Ellen from the tropical island of St. Barts, and today we have another great interview on Light Talk.
And this is David coming to you from the beautiful Belmont Shore neighborhood of Long Beach, California. And if you don't already know, you are listening to Light Talk, and we are the Lumen Brothers.
And sister.
Oh, you better believe that. Well, welcome everyone to episode 309. And today we have a very special guest, the one and only, incomparable, amazing, Bob Barnhart. Welcome, Bob, to the show. How you doing, man?
I was doing really well until I just found out I was the 308th guest.
No.
300. Some people you'd rather talk to than me.
Eventually, you're going to work your way up.
Actually, all of the shows don't have a guest.
That's true.
Some of them are just Lumen nonsense.
All right, good cover.
But you know what? Bob should be the anniversary special guest for our anniversary
show?
Well,
that's in 2 weeks, isn't it? When's our anniversary show?
That's what I'm saying.
I think we just didn't have the courage to call you up.
Yeah, we were intimidated.
They needed me. What can I tell you?
It took Ellen to do it.
Yeah. No, that's it. Yeah.
You're not an easy get, Bob. I mean, let's face it. Okay. But I think we should make him the anniversary show. Hold him back a week, release him on the anniversary, and we say special guest interview.
So you want to do another show tomorrow for the next week?
Sure.
No, that's right.
If that's what it takes to elevate Bob, I'm all for it.
I think it's just going to be an insane anniversary show. No guest. We'll just have fun.
No.
Yeah, Bob.
We could do it. We have Bob.
I think that's the perfect segue into having Ellen explain why we wanted Bob to be on
this
episode.
Why?
There you go. Let's hear some bit about Bob.
Okay. I'd be happy to. 12-time Emmy winner and longtime lighting designer for television, having designed 22 Academy Award shows, 21 Super Bowl halftime shows, plus the VMAs, Miss Universe, AMAs, and ESPY Awards, among others. Co-founder in 2016 of the distinguished lighting firm 22 Degrees, a cooperative of lighting designers working around the globe on a diverse portfolio of shows. Bob's recent project roster includes the Kennedy Center Honors, 25th season of Family Feud, and the upcoming PBS 50th anniversary of Great Performances. Hey, Bob, it's great to have you on the show.
Thanks for having me.
Hey, I got to say one thing, Bob, before anybody. I've been watching your work for decades, and let me just say this. It's my first time meeting you, but everything I have seen, it looks marvelous.
Thank you.
And Bob, I have a question. You got 12 Emmys. When are you going for the Baker's Dozen?
He goes for it every day of his life.
I go for it on every show I possibly do. I have kind of a simple objective. I of course want to be very happy with the work I do each time I do it, but I always kind of look at it and think, can I do something on the show that would make, you know, my colleagues acknowledge our work, or, you know, make them look at it and think that's good. That's a good piece of work. You can't do it, you know, in an entire show, but you look for moments in a show that you try and, you know, hit that mark. So that's definitely an objective I go after every show I do.
Nice. You're in good company, because Abraham Lincoln said the highest compliment would be to be held in high esteem by your colleagues. And I think
other politicians? Is that what Lincoln was going for?
Well, Lincoln was sort of a special guy. You know, he wasn't like the ordinary politician. Right. Well,
I think, Bob, you've proved your point. Damn it.
And it's hard. I mean, you know, 22 times with that large golden Academy Award Oscar on the stage. How do you make it look different every time? You know, it's challenging.
It is challenging, you know, but you take that show in particular as just an award show with a higher end to it, in the sense of like everybody in the, you know, first 30 rows wants to look fantastic, which is incredibly difficult depending upon the set and all of that, you know, all the angles that you could possibly shoot them with handheld cameras and things. So you always have to take an approach on these types of award shows of, you know, how can I make it look as good as possible? But I don't like I personally am not a fan of being different to be different. There is a production design to the show. There is a producer's approach to the show. And, you know, we have to be there to help tell that story and not make our own story. That's my own personal theory. I don't necessarily want to be noticed by somebody that does not do this for a living. I would definitely like to be noticed by people who do it for a living, but by people who don't do it for a living, I want to have enhanced the story. You know, we've done 17 seasons of So You Think You Could Dance, and I think one of the greatest things we are always able to do on that show is just really help tell that choreographer's story, right? They've picked a piece of music, they've chosen their dancers, they've come up with this choreography, they have a story they want to tell. How can we help tell that story where people feel that that dance has really been enhanced, but they couldn't tell you it was lighting?
How much lead time do you have on the Academy Awards?
Academy Awards usually starts conversations about the set design in November, and how far is it going to go? How far are you going to take it? You know, what's the signature of the show? What do the new producers, if there are new producers that year, what do they want to do? Maybe that feels different, or, you know, how can we support what they'll a lot of times watch previous, you know, years and come back with a question of why is it done this way? Why don't you do something like this?
And what about the Super Bowl? What kind of lead time?
Super Bowl is a different animal. So what happens with the Super Bowl is usually in about April, so the year before, the halftime team will go to the stadium and understand what the stadium can and can't do. Couldn't support overhead rigging, for instance, right? What is the tunnel access to get everything on the field? And are there restrictions to that? You know, what capabilities does this building have? So that by the time they pick the talent, which is usually in about August, maybe late July, we're already ready to sit down with them and kind of have an idea of what the building can and can't do. There's some mandatory meetings with the NFL. The first one's in June. And in June, you have to pick all your seat kills, which is, of course, a really difficult thing to do because you don't even have a talent picked, let alone a show produced. So that's just kind of part of that. That's a bigger game that particular animal, you know, is a little bit different because, you know, it's about a football game.
Do architects who are doing these new stadiums, do they reach out to you and or people like you and say, let's talk about entertainment in this space?
So there's a company that's hired by the NFL Populous is the name of the company, and they make the Super Bowl happen, which has to do with all the footprints taken up outside the stadium for, you know, halftime, for the teams, for all the logistics that goes on inside. All the power companies. Populous also designs stadiums. So when they get involved with a new stadium, we have discussions with them, but we do beg other companies just to call and ask. Just simple things like, you know, chimneys that go from the top of the stadium down to the bottom level where we can drop cable. Just simple chimneys, which don't cost any money to put in, you know, within their infrastructure of closets. But no, they don't ask, and it's sort of irritating.
Yeah, I wouldn't think so. We think we're a big piece of it, but we're really kind of a small piece.
Yeah, but even theaters, when they get built, even in LA, right, they don't ask. And we consulted on the Kodak Theater, the Dolby Theater, whatever you know it as. And I'd say they took on about 25% of everybody's ideas. But that 25% was a big difference. You know, I could walk you around the building and show you the things that we got put in, but it made a big difference to just be able to get that kind of stuff in. It really didn't cost any more money. It was just a matter of, you know, approaching the project with some needs in mind.
So these guys are like a specialty architecture firm that just does stadiums. That's their gig.
Yeah, stadiums that are reworking the stadiums. You're going to do an Olympics and an opening and closing ceremonies for an Olympics in a stadium. They might come in and do a full rework on it.
Yeah. But also these stadiums house concerts that have nothing to do with sporting events. And you would think that they would build them and design them for easy load-in and load-outs for lighting and sound.
Yeah, well, let's take my company name for it. It's 22 degrees. It refers to a good light angle for your key light to count, right? So when you're gonna walk into a theater and go, okay, I'm gonna do an award show in here. 50 different faces are gonna walk in front of my key light. So let's assume it's a follow spot. I want to be about 22.5 degrees out there. So you find a spot and go, look, I'd like to put my fellow spots in the back of the second balcony, right? So we're going to kill those seats. So the Nokia Theater, which is now, I believe, the Microsoft Theater, or I got it back, whatever it is. Anyway, down in downtown LA, they built this arena, right? A theater right next to Staples Center, as it were, called earlier, where we were working about every 4 months. And we said, can we just talk about where you're going to put the key light position so that we can just have it in the same place? So they put it at 35 degrees, which is just too steep. And walk in there for the first time to your first show, and there's follow spot bridge permanently built there at 35 degrees. You're like, at 22 to 24 degrees, there's no obstructions. You could have built it here. And they said, well, the touring people don't care. And they said, you know what the touring people also don't care about? 22 degrees.
Can I drill down on that answer a little bit, Bob? Because it fascinates me. So the 22 degrees to what target? Like the podium, the curtain line? Where do you want that ideal angle to land?
Well, it's to your face. So let's just assume you take a 6 foot tall person. And what we do is we just basically go to kind of the hero spot on the stage, you know.
The hero spot. Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, so stage right, stage left, presenter podiums, let's say an acceptance podium. An acceptance speech podium is going to be the same place that Taylor Swift is going to sing a song from, as far as a general zone.
So right? So that target can't be a mobile target. That is the sweet spot where you want 22 to land.
Yeah, you're going to go for the sweet spot of, hey, they're probably going to stand in this 10-foot circle area and perform in here. And so I'm going to go 22 out and see what I hit, and I'll take that. I don't want to go flatter. I throw a longer shadow, right?
Yeah.
I don't want to go steeper because it gets hard on the face. It's something I teach in the lectures I do about the close-up. Just one thing that you don't have to think of as a lighting designer when you're just doing it for live events. You don't have to think about the close-up. You could sit 5 feet from somebody, and it is nothing like a close-up on a camera.
Right. The camera sees everything. Yeah. Right.
Yeah. And you want to enhance the face.
Isn't it true, Bob, that most of these shows, like 80% of the show is right there?
You know, unfortunately, it's true. A lighting designer wants 80% of the show to be a wide shot. You know, and the talent's management was wanting 99% of the show to be a close-up, unless it's Madonna. Apparently, then it's supposed to be further than 20 feet away.
I had a question about that. You know, I think a reason why they have the Academy Awards and a lot of award shows in LA is because we have the best plastic surgeons in Southern California. Because a follow-up to that, I was going to ask, have you ever, you don't have to mention names, has there ever been someone who came up there who you could not help? With all your brilliance, there was nothing you could do to help this person.
Oh, God, yes.
Okay, that's where we're going to end this.
I've consulted for Debbie Reynolds, Barbara Streisand, Ellen DeGeneres, and Drew Barrymore. And as Debbie Reynolds said a long time ago, you specialize in aging white women. there are just certain things you can't totally overcome. There's just no way. But between a good lighting setup and a good video operator on the camera, there's a lot you can do. And obviously a good makeup artist, but there's a lot you can do. There's some things you just can't do. But I will tell you a funny story about that. The first time I was hired by Patrick Woodruff of the Rolling Stones LD to come out and do an HBO TV special of the Rolling Stones, I'm working with them. I'm adjusting their lighting so it looks correct for TV, which is a long conversation, but it's one of the classes I teach. Not trying to change the lighting, just trying to make it so it looks the same on the TV monitor that it did the day before to their eyes. And we do a full show. It wasn't the live broadcast for HBO. And the next day we're in doing notes. That night will be the live show. And Mick Jagger comes up and says, can you not do that tonight? And I said, do what? And he said, make me look good. I thought, that is absolutely the first time I've ever been asked that question.
Well, next to Keith Richards, he looks like the handsomest person in the world.
So what are we saying? That's his brand, not looking good?
I think he likes the edginess. I've certainly had other people ask me to make him look a little edgy, but I thought, well, next to Steven Tyler, you look fantastic, but I'm not sure that's my beau-frère. Anyway, it was very funny, it's a very easy fix, so it was not enough. Not a big request.
Yeah, but an unusual one, right?
Yeah, but a very unusual one, yeah.
You know, we sort of started in the middle here, but just to go rewind a second, how did you get into the business and specialize in TVs and award shows? I mean, you didn't just like jump in and say, hey, I want to do the Academy Awards.
No, I didn't. But funny enough, I did watch the Academy Awards when we were kids. But I never really thought I would do TV lighting, because if you asked me back then, and maybe it was even more true than now, but I would have thought TV lighting is just a bunch of white light and that's not theatrical. It's not interesting. But the quick story of how I got in the business was when I was 16, there was a theater in town, you know, like basically if anybody was on tour, they stopped off at this theater to do their show, and nobody wanted to work on the crew. So my mother was teaching at Chico State, American history. I was going to high school, and this theater, this civic theater, if you will, is actually attached to the campus of Chico State. And they would pay you twice of minimum wage if you would come in and unload the truck, set up the gear, work on some crew position on the show, and then, you know, load the trucks back up and wave goodbye. And my brothers were working at Taco Bell, and I thought, wow, twice the minimum wage and not have to work in fast food sounds like a really cool thing. And one day I'm running a follow spot for Billy Idol, Carbon Arc Super Trooper follow spot, just to age me without giving you years. And about three rows behind my follow spot were two of my high school friends who paid to go to the show, and I thought, I'm being paid to do the show. And it's really cool. And, you know, you go backstage and there's everybody and all the inner workings. And I was always really into woodworking and things like that and rigging. And I thought this was really cool. So anyway, I just kept pursuing that, and I ended up getting a scholarship to finish my last 2 years of college at California Institute of the Arts in Southern California. I had to change my major to be a technical director because they were starting a new technical directing program. So they offered me a scholarship for my last 2 years. Before I graduated, I had already started working for Flying by Foy, if you are familiar with them.
Yes, we are.
I was traveling all over the country. My first time I ever got on an airplane was for Foy.
Were you one of those guys who set up the rigs for Peter Pan then?
Yeah, so I did seven years of Peter Pan. I traveled with Kathy Rigby for 2 years around Canada and North America. I've done Superman the Musical. If you ever see that on a playbill, don't go. It's horrible. I flew Phyllis Diller as the Wicked Witch in Kansas City.
That must have been a story.
That was fantastic. outdoor theater, Starlight Theater, outdoor theater in Kansas City. If you've ever been there, it's a fantastic venue. It's sort of like the Hollywood Bowl. Anyway, so I had a lot of fun stories from Foy, and I got called in on a TV show to ask if I could rig some pipes for the lighting department, and it offered $250 for 10. I was making about $100 a day before that, and I didn't know what $250 for 10 meant. So I asked the guy who was hiring me, he goes, if we go at past 10 hours, I'll pay you overtime. And to me, overtime was like Brigadoon. I'd only heard songs and stories about it. I'd never seen it. So I went in that first day. I wore a white t-shirt on purpose and blue jeans. I wore a white t-shirt because I knew I'd be up in the grid, and the studio grids are dirty. And I wanted to come out looking like Pigpen so that they knew I'd, you know, was a hard worker. And it worked, because by lunch, they asked me to come back the next day. So now it's $500. That's a full week of work I'm going to get in 2 days.
That's
and
great.
By the second day, they asked me if I wanted to work on the series. It was a TV's sitcom called It's Gary Shandling Show.
I remember that show.
Yeah,
I worked on it for 3 years, and then it went away. I moved over to Married with Children for 1 year, and that's where I got my first union card. And honestly, sitcom lighting is a bunch of white light. I mean, it's at the time, it really was not very interesting, but it was very educational for me because it was all about the face, all about close-ups, all about hiding and burying shadows, all these things that, and lighting scenery, which is a whole nother discussion that you have to get into when you're teaching somebody that only does live lighting, what TV lighting is about. So that all in all was very educational. Anyway, I met a famous lighting designer by the name of Bill Klages during the time period I was on Married with Children. He was not the lighting designer for Married with Children. That's another famous story about the princess, Markle. He said, what are you doing here? If you came from theater, you should be in television specials. And so long story short, I started working with the Klages Group. Bob Dickinson and I met up from the Klages Group. We partnered up, had Full Flood for a long time. And I've been a full-time television light designer since 1997.
Great story.
Yeah. And I don't know all of your stories, but I bet you they're not that far off, right? I mean, a lot of people's stories that I do know, you know, you kind of fall in love with the business and you wander around the woods until you find a nice meadow and then you go play around in it.
Yeah, it's nice.
We still are doing a monthly Zoom. We started during COVID, about five designers. And we do a monthly Zoom with Bill. It was beyond instinct. It was full knowledge of why you would put a light where you put it. And he's actually the one that came up with 22.5 degrees as your good starting point until you know a face, or if you have multiple faces, that that's your good point. So when I made the company, well, I'm sorry, when I made the company 22 degrees and I named it, you know, 22 degrees, we got 22degrees.com. He called me and said, you made a mistake. It's 22.5.
0.5.
And I said, you know, I said, Bill, that's in the right day and age of websites, 22.5.com is going to get really confusing. So we went with 22.
Yeah, that would.
My favorite line he ever said was he and Red McKinnon said, you know, we started doing lighting for television when it was still radio.
and it's a true story. Red McKinnon actually literally used to light for radio because, you know, there were live performances with audiences. So
yes, that's right.
They wanted to be able to see the audience.
So what are you working on right now?
PBS's 50th anniversary of a series they call Great Performances, which I've done many of, which is, you know, like Andre Bocelli in Portofino or Central Park, a lot of opera music specials. They capture some Broadway stuff, you know, and it's the PBS station out of New York. They do a lot of great work and they're really nice people to work with. And just to age me, I did the 40th anniversary. So we're back. But anyway, yeah, very happy to always work with them. They always do really classy work.
50 years. That's amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing.
You know, Bob, you were talking earlier about teaching and how you teach your students and all that. And I know that you are starting to work with Clifton and the rest of the gang at the Studio School of Design, which I'm a huge fan of. And, you know, all of us here are, you know, we're all educators.
Very supportive, yeah.
And I think this is really the wave of the future. I mean, I think graduate schools are basically going to go away. I know that my colleagues may not believe that, but eventually I think that it's all going to be done in a way where you have these amazing professionals like you actually teaching classes. Or that maybe they'll be, you know, integrated into grad schools. I think that would be the wiser thing for schools to do right now. Why don't you tell us a little bit how you got involved in that and which courses you are teaching and which courses you would like to teach?
Sure. First of all, I totally agree with you about Studio School of Design. I'm also a big supporter and fan of the Hemsley scholarship program. Mm-hmm. I feel like, and I would hope everybody else feels this way too, that I got into this business and am still receiving a lot of help, but I got into this business because of so much help and guidance and mentoring and people just willing to, you know, give me their time. And I've always felt it's important to do that, to give that back. So for a long time, I have developed two-hour classes on the difference of lighting for the camera's eye opposed to your eye. And I have gone to, you know, University of North Carolina School of the Arts or, you know, Cal Arts and Chico and USC and UCLA and a lot of schools and done these classes. And then when COVID hit, I reached out to all the professors I know around the country and just offered up my classes because I figured they weren't ready to be teaching online, but I was quite used to it because I always use PowerPoint to keep me on script. So it was easy for me to adjust to it, to just to be online, even, you know, I did it when it was in person. So I liked all of that. And I did a class for Mark Stanley, in Boston, who's part of course, a big part of it with Clifton. And he reached out to me several years ago, said, we're starting this new school. Can you be a part of it? And of course, I love that. And then a year and a half ago, I guess, I did one of these lighting for TV classes for them, 8 classes, 2 hours each, which is what I'm doing this time as well, starting March 4th. But basically what I do is I just try and take you through the process of this is how the camera sees contrast. This is how the camera interprets color. You can manipulate that. You can adjust with that. You can do all that, but you can't get your idea on camera if you don't understand how the camera sees what you're doing. So we spend the first couple days understanding what, how, and why the camera sees things, and then how we play with that to get it to see the way we see it or want to see it. And then I break down things like set designs, because in lighting for television, you have to light everything you want to see. You want to light everything you want to see. So because you're trying to build up your contrast level, and that means you want to touch everything you can touch so you can give it a little different light level, maybe a little different color tone, and that expands your contrast level, which is the restriction of a light broadcast camera. eye's got a 2,000-to-1 contrast, the human eye, and a live broadcast camera's got a 650-to-1. So if you just think yeah. that it has 1/4, we need to enhance that contrast level for the camera so everything looks more vibrant and deep and interesting. So what's really important in that is lighting the set. So we have to work with the production designer long, long, long before it goes to the shop of how each piece is going to get lit. That also, of course, goes with the venue as well or anything else you want to see. So we break down those kind of things. I do deal with how to make soft light on someone's face. I've developed a thing I call the long throw soft light, which I used the Super Bowls for years, which is, you know, a 250-foot long throwing soft light that's under great control.
Wow.
If you think of a movie soft light, that's going to be like a big 20 by 20 soap. That's not going to work out in the theater. So I use that for my ladies I consult with. The Drew Barrymore talk show is lit entirely with long throw soft lights. To take some of the mystery out of that term, it's just a series of lekos very precisely hung. So I teach those kind of things and, you know, how to get in the creative things, the cool things you can do with the camera that you can't do in a live, you know, show. In other words, I can move all 3,000 people in the theater into the same exact seat, right? Because you're moving the camera around, so you can do so many really cool things. You can do some really subtle lighting that's really fun that just wouldn't work in a live environment. You know, no front light at all, heavy backlight, because the camera's going to be, you know, 4 inches off their nose, and you can really get into things and make them drag. So I, you know, try and bring some fun into the classes as well. The other class I teach, but I don't do it at studio school, it's sign, is I have developed a 1-hour lecture called Attitude, Work Ethic, and Personality Are Your Keys to Success.
That'd be a good class.
I'd love for you to love your skill set. It's important for you to love your skill set, but your boss is really interested in you.
And you know,
how you're going to do it. It is assumed at the professional level that you know how to do your job. What's not assumed is how well you execute, you know, how you're going through that at the time. Like, you get excited when someone comes up and goes, we have a problem with no solution. I get excited personally. I'm like, ah, opportunity. What's the problem? Let's figure it out. It doesn't even have to be in my department. I get excited. So
that's soft skills. We're soft skills right there.
Yeah.
Speaking of soft skills, you're talking about mentors and how we learn. Yes. Like Mark, Gilbert was my mentor, and these people are invaluable. And professionals like you who share this, it could be worldwide. I mean, that's the great thing about distance learning is that, you know, people from the Faroe Islands could take your class, you know?
Exactly right.
Matter of fact, there are 7 line designers on the Faroe Islands. I don't know if you know
really.
That, but they do listen to our show.
That's funny.
It's just amazing that you do this. And I'd like to thank you for all the students, you know, in the world who did that.
Hey, let me just put this out there right now. I live in a swamp in North Florida with 55,000 students. Bob, how do I sign up? And actually, I have a student now who went to the studio school last spring, and he's in my class now. And boy, he's got some really sharp skills. So I agree that that's where it's heading.
Yeah, Studio School of Design. Yeah, I mean, it's an 8-session. It's an 8-session, 2 hours session. It's a lot of class. We spend an entire 2-hour class with just talking to a video operator, understanding how the lighting designer can sit down with the video operator and have some dialogue where the show can get better. The video operator needs to understand what you're trying to achieve and why you're picking your white balance the way you are, and why you're picking your light levels the way you are, and maybe what some of your problems and or concerns are in the show. And they can really, really help you. But if you haven't spent a lot of time with them, it could be quite intimidating, because they have a bunch of stuff in front of them, that buttons and knobs that make no sense to you if you've never sat down and just talked to them. So we sit down for a full class and just talk about what can go wrong, what can go well, how they can help you, how they can kill you. That kind of stuff is really good to do. So that's the one good thing about doing an 8-session class with Studio School of Design. But, you know, the classes I do also where I just do it to a particular classroom, there's a lot to get out of that as well.
But this class for Studio School is online, yes?
It is online. I think the last time I did it, like you were saying, as I think we had 9 different countries. There's a guy in Bangkok, Thailand. It was midnight his time, and he was there every time. He didn't ask any questions till the last class. And I said, you're finally talking, because I'm very, very interactive. The class is only good if you are involved. No good if you just sit there and listen to me. It's useless. But if you get involved and ask questions and make sure you understand, if you turn into a three-year-old, right, and keep asking why until you understand, we'll lock it in. And it was the last day he finally asked questions. I said, I can't remember his name. I said, you're finally asking questions. He goes, well, I've done all of your classes sitting in my bedroom with my brother sleeping next to me, so I couldn't talk.
That is so sweet. Oh my God, that's incredible.
So the class seems to be called Lighting Live Events for Camera, right?
Yeah.
And you talk about working in HD and 4K environments, which I assume are things that did not exist when you and I started our careers. So how do you, like, what's happened over the years and, you know, about gear changing and the cameras changing and the lighting changing, and it's all different?
Yeah, it's actually gotten better, right? So we've gone for probably a 450-to-1 contrast ratio. We're probably actually at about 750, if you really want to get picky, in live broadcast cameras. Live broadcast cameras are different because they have to send the information instantaneously off to your supplier. Movies that are shot digitally, even on film, get processed. They go through a very long processing system. So that camera is able to gather a lot more information into its recording device, and then get processed. It doesn't have to be able to also turn around and broadcast out. So its contrast levels are up like to 1200, which is why movies, you know, honestly look a little, you know, deeper and richer and maybe a little more realistic, where it doesn't require so much additional contrast lighting to give you depth. So we do talk about that, but yeah, as far as like lighting for 4K or even 8K these days, it's not bad. You just get away with less. You know, as Barbara Streisand once said, right when these new, you know, 16:9 format TVs were coming out and 4K cameras, she goes, this face is not for 4K.
There are a lot of faces. And I have a question for you, Bob. What type of monitor do you use at your home when you're watching movies?
Great question.
Cable?
Yeah, so funny, though. So when I'm going to buy a new TV, first thing I do, I call one of my video operator friends and go, what's going on? What TV do I want? So I've got a pretty good Sony TV. And of course, the key to it is, one, your provider can kill you.
Absolutely.
It's nerve wracking to know when you're sending a show out live, what other people might be seeing. You just don't know. So it is about the setup of your TV to, ideally be taking in how your provider tends to send things out. You've got these people, you know, these things go up onto a satellite. So let's say you're doing a live, let's say you're doing the VMAs, right? MTV sends it up to a dish, and then a lot of people grab it, DirecTV, Spectrum, whoever's grabbing it, right? And then they send it back out to their customers. There could be a person literally in that receiving area who grabs a knob and goes, I think it looks bright. I got to turn it down a little bit.
Interesting.
And you're like, we consulted on CNN a million years ago when they wanted to redo all their studios. And we consulted on it. So they've got, LA, Atlanta, New York, right? All the stuff going on. And we got all of our guys in each studio. We're all live talking to each other, and someone goes, I think you're pretty dark in there. I'm like, no, it's not dark. So you call the guy in Atlanta who's receiving all the feeds first. I'm like, is it dark? He's like, the incoming's not dark. The outgoing's definitely dark. Let me find the guy. He's at lunch. And, you know, he had turned a knob down because the previous input was too bright.
Huh. Right.
Of somebody else who was downloading.
Is it an OLED TV or Sony?
My Sony is not an OLED. Oh, I'm sorry, it is an OLED TV. I'm sorry, I got a new TV last year.
The reason why I bring that up is because I also have an OLED TV. And when Game of Thrones was doing their last season, they had that one episode, which was really dark. It got a lot of criticism for it. And I was saying, I can't believe it looks this bad. But, you know, it may have been the provider. It may have been DirecTV doing that.
Absolutely.
A lot of people don't realize. I'm glad you brought that up.
Oh, yeah. It's absolutely true. We spend 10 minutes on this in my class so you get to the day where you're going to go on camera, your first day you're going to go on camera, and you, you go up to your video person who's, you know, pulling their hair out because they're trying to set up all these cameras and all these monitors. And you're like, you know, the best monitor on a TV show when you're actually shooting a TV show is the video operator's monitor. Absolutely, the next best monitor's got to be mine. But the next best monitor has got to be the producer who's going to be coming into you going, this looks horrible. They can't just be looking at some regular TV that hasn't been adjusted. So one thing these video operators run all over the place doing on day one is, you know, putting up bars on the on their TV and color painting the contrast and the color to get it right, because there's just nothing worse than that. And as a person who deals with consulting with particular talent that's sort of particular about the way they look, before that talent ever gets there, you get a monitor set up where you can give them a view of the playback that's got to be a great monitor. And if I can't do that, I will drag them all the way into the video truck, because I'm just not going to go through that. And actually, I just wanted to follow up one thing that Ellen asked about, you know, things changing. You know, the advent of LED fixtures, I'm not talking about color blast. I'm talking about, you know, profile fixtures and things like that, that are, the field's flat. The field's so flat, it's so great, because with 4K, you know, you get even a regular follow spot that might have a 15% difference in its field, and you're shooting at 30-foot candles, you know, it's noticeable as it moves around on them a little bit. So these flat field fixtures, for me, who, you know, just has a lot of time, I have to deal with, you know, an extreme close-up or something, it's fantastic.
Well, let me ask you a question about that then. Are you in a position now where you are talking to manufacturers about specifics that you want? Are you having software or optic trains built specifically for you?
I don't think anybody would build anything specific for me, but I've been talking to manufacturers. They've been reaching out to us for 20 years. And I, you know, always happy to give you my opinion and look at what you're working on and all of that, because, you know, we all have to use it. And I'm only one opinion, but, you know, we definitely have driven. I would like to think that the VL2600 was driven by a lot of requests that we've been putting in for over 10 years, 15 years, not just with the LED flat field, but also size and you know, form factor on the outside. We have to deal with a lot of people's opinions about what a light looks like when you put it on the floor or on a piece of physically on a piece of scenery or something. And if it looks like, you know, an egg that fell off a wall, they're less happy about the idea of putting it there. So, you know, that form factor is a big deal in our end of the world. And so, you know, we kind of just kind of keep that pressed. But I was brought in by a manufacturer who, they know who they are, but we'll keep them out of this, years ago, until we have a new family of LED lights we want to look at. And they had a nice profile fixture and they had a nice wash fixture. And I asked, why did you make a wash fixture? I'm like, well, a lot of people use them. I said, okay. I said, I stopped using wash fixtures 6 years ago. So I had them all leave the room. I moved their lights around, worked with their programmer, brought them back in the, you know, how those demo rooms are, right? You can't see your hand in front of your face. And I said, okay, which one's your wash light and which one's your profile? And their response was, good point.
You couldn't tell, yeah.
Yeah, with a good, you know, yeah. with a good profile diffusion. Fixture, it's got good diffusion, good frosting capabilities, and take it out of focus.
Yeah.
You know, I would, and you've heard me say this before if you've ever heard me talk, but if I can afford a light every 8 feet on my electrics, I would like a Swiss Army knife.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Not a knife, of course. A fork, and a spoon. Right.
Of course. And I agree with that.
I had to call up, you know, one of my good friends and business partners, Matt Firestone, when I started using these fixtures. And I said, am I crazy? I don't think I need wash fixtures. I just don't think I need them. I think I'm wasting my money. And yes, they're cheaper, but I just think I'm wasting my money. And he goes, no, I think you're right. Now, having said that, I have certainly thrown wash fixtures in when I'm going to light an arena of audience, but I want it to be automated and colorable. I'm going to grab a wash fixture because it's cheaper. Mm. And I only need to do one thing, and that's pump out a lot of color in a soft edge. So if it's collecting dust on a rental shop's shelf, I'll you know, get it because I can get it for less money. But in general, I mean, if you saw Annie live, there was a one lost. There was actually one. There was only 26. There was 500, 2600s on it and some LED fixtures to do, you know, scenic exact things. Miss Universe I just did in New Orleans, all 2600s except for some stuff that the house had that we were able to use at a low price. The 50th anniversary of PBS, it's all 2600s except for some Diablos because they fit into a smaller space than I need. And I'm not saying 2600 is the best light in the world. I think there's a lot of good lights. Diablo is one of them. Martin's fixtures are good too. And then there's some house Lekos on the job to light audience and architecture because it's free. So I'm just making my point.
You still do use some conventionals when they come around.
Yeah, you just can't. I mean, I can't beat a $12 Leko. A $12 right. Leko that's going to light audience. Right. I'm never going to match that, right? I mean, last year's ESPY Awards, ESPN Sports Awards, the set was came out from the proscenium into the house and was very complicated, and we were very worried about how we would focus Lekos on the audience physically just to get into them. So we actually did bite the bullet and light the whole lower orchestra portion of the audience with automated fixtures just to get around that problem. I would love to do it. You know, just don't have that kind of, I know you guys think we have gigantic budgets, but they all fit the scale of what people are expecting in their show, right? Or right. They don't actually fit. They're 25% less.
Are there ever sets that are just like really hard to light, like the Academy Awards covered with Swarovski crystals or things like that?
Yeah, there's a lot of sets that are really hard to light, and I use a couple of them in my Studio School of Design examples. And again, going back to it, they're hard to light, so we have to work with the production designer, and they have to be workable, hopefully, to get through the process of, look, I understand how you want the set to look. I'll do everything I can to make it look this way, but I need help in either moving this or that, or this surface you're picking is way too reflective, right? I mean, we talk about chrome and mirrors and you know, reflections and hotspots and refractions. There's a really cool set design example in my class from VMAs in 2017, which is this massive amount of triangles all connected together to make a proscenium, to make the stage piece, to make ceiling pieces. And every little faceted triangle, the production designer wanted each one to be different color, different texture. It's like, there's no way one I could afford that many lights. And if you look at the angles of hitting all these triangles, there's just no place to rig all these different angles. It's not possible, but I like your concept. So what we did was all those triangles and pyramids and things, if you can picture, were made out of fabric stretched over these pyramids, triangle type frames. And we picked five different types of silver material that reflected differently or didn't reflect at all and applied them, not randomly, but all over these pyramids. So when I hit the pyramid with one light, all the different angles took the light differently. So it appeared that, you know, we had done what he had in his renderings.
Nice. Very nice.
It's just a process of working together to do that, which is why it's such an important conversation, right? I always think in schools, teachers should be grabbing the set design students and grabbing the lighting designer students and pairing them up.
Absolutely.
And saying, work this rendering or model that is going to cost $17 million to make. Work it out and tell me how you're going to light it. That's a great ceiling piece. How do I get light on the people back there?
You know, speaking of schools, Bob, we always like to end off these amazing interviews with the question, what advice would you give a young student of lighting design right now as they wind their way through the process of education and also what may be starting in the industry right now? What bit of advice would you give them?
Yeah. So first of all, I'm with everybody here that I'm not a graduate school fan. If you're going to go to college, your teacher should be exhausted of you after 4 years.
Yeah. Oh, that happens.
Yeah, man, absolutely. I mean, you should not worry about graduating. If you ask them enough questions, they're going to sign your diploma on your third year just to get you the hell out of there.
Just to get out of there.
But you should absolutely exhaust your professors. You should exhaust the resources at your facilities and get everything out of it that you can. And in the meantime, you should also be reaching out to people in the professional world who do what you want to do or even involved in the area of what you want to do and ask if you can interview them. Mm-hmm. Not ask for a job, that's a yes or no question. And the answer is going to be no. But ask if you can interview them. Ask if you can pick their brain. Ask how they got started. Ask genuine questions that you really want to know the answers to. What advice would you have for me at my stage? How did you get started in the business? What does a young employee look like to you? And, you know, what skills do they need? And if the conversation goes well, hey, you said you were doing a load-in next Tuesday. I don't have any classes Tuesday. Any chance I can just come down and watch this process and understand it? Because if you go back to my other lecture, Attitude, Work Ethic, and Personality, it's about your reputation, right? It's about what other people think of you. And obviously, if they don't know you, they don't think anything of you. But what we're trying to do is get our reputation out there, which is get more people to know us, know who we are, know what we're about, and understand that, hey, I got a good attitude and, you know, I got a great work ethic and I'm, you know, dying to get into this business just like you were 35 years ago. So that's always my advice is these doors in front of you are made out of paper. So just kick them in politely. Email is such a great way to do it because if the person's busy and they just can't deal with it at the time, they'll just delete it. And if they don't delete it and they have time, they'll answer it when they can. I probably get an email a week from somebody like that. And I go out of my way to answer them. And I have failed here and there on answering somebody, but I try very hard to always answer them and just give them a little advice of what their next step should be. The thing I like about Studio School of Design, as we were all talking, because I'm not a master school fan, I think you should go out there and get real experience. And I also don't think schools should just be hiring people with masters to teach. I'd rather you hire people with extensive experience to teach. Is Studio School of Design to me is like extended learning, right? It's that cherry pick your own type of classes, but let's go get some professional training that maybe it would be hard to get somewhere else.
Sounds like a good recipe.
Yeah.
So Bob, the Lumen Brothers and sister would like to thank you for such a great interview. As a matter of fact,
it's almost Fez worthy. We might have to send you a Fez.
This interview was Fez worthy, and it's also worthy as a legend of light. You are one of our legends of light, Bob.
Oh, wow.
I mean, we have a whole series of the creme de la creme of interviewees. And
I get a drinking cup or something that says that? I want a drinking cup.
You'll get a Fez. We'll give you a Fez.
A Fez.
Personally signed by the Lumen Brothers and sisters. Right?
We also have not safe for dishwasher coffee mugs.
We do have the not safe for dishwasher coffee mugs and shot glasses, which we highly recommend. The shot glass really helps at the beginning of your day.
I was doing Miss Universe in Russia, and I'd gone three times for surveys and meetings, and slowly the house crew warmed up to me. And once my guys all showed up and we got going, everything was smooth and everybody was happy. And I'm like, day four of load-in, I walk in and I say hi to the head electrician who, you know, like at Radio City, mainly it's just an office position. And he goes, Bob, come here. So I go into his office and, you know, there's paper stacked up to the ceiling because he's been there for 50 years. And he pulls out a bottle of vodka and he goes, vodka? And I like vodka, but
sure,
not until afterwards.
Join the club.
Let me be really clear about this, but I'm not until afterwards. So I go, no, it's 8 o'clock in the morning. I think I'll wait until after work. He goes, he holds up a shot glass that's empty. And he goes, this is not drinking. Let's kind of drinking. He goes, no, this is not drinking. So the good news is in Russia, a shot glass in the morning is not drinking.
That's right. It's nothing. Listen, I've worked with a lot of Russians and I've worked in Russia too. And you are absolutely right. It's not like working in London and a crew takes you out for beers during dinner break. They're going to take you out to the pub across the street. Yeah. You go with them.
Yeah. You know, the first time that happened to me in England, they handed me a beer. I don't really drink a lot of beer. I'm a red wine vodka guy. Not the same exact time. But I said, well, just pick me a beer that you think is, you know, British. The beer was room temperature.
Yes, it's warm.
Always.
And I look at these guys and I go, do you know that World War II is over and you can plug your refrigerators back in?
Like, oh my God, that is funny.
Please.
Oh my God.
For the love of God. I mean, just there's nothing wrong with cold beer.
Well, I think you were in a much better position to say that than I was. I drank that warm syrup, you know, and I smiled and I thanked them. And when we went back to work.
Right.
Well, the rocking sounds of the Luminoids tells us that once again, you've spent another morning listening to Light Talk. You can hear our show on just about every podcast site out there. Check out our website at lighttalk.org and be sure to follow us on Facebook and subscribe to the podcast. That way you will not miss a second of Light Talk Insanity.
No guarantee is offered regarding the accuracy of any statements or opinions made on this podcast. However,
if you do decide to litigate, the Snoop Group, with the legal team of Sparks, Burnout, and Chase, will defend us until our retirement funds are depleted.
Light Talk is written and produced by the Lumen Brothers and Sister, coming to you from Long Beach, Pasadena, St. Bart's, and the Republic of Texas.
And be sure to join us next week when we talk about more lighting shenanigans and serve you more of our casserole of nonsense.
Light Talk, broadcasting questionable Lumen knowledge and humor around the world.
And thank you again to our legend of light, Bob Barnhart, today. And we'll see you all next Saturday morning. Bye-bye from Light Talk.
Toodles.